Yeah, hello everyone, and thank you for joining us at the 2020 Comic-Con At Home Edition. My name is Maurice Chapdelaine. I'm one of the producers of The Order, and I'm really excited to, well, reintroduce you to some very well-known faces, our stars and the creators and producers of The Order. We have Jake Manley, of course, who plays Jack.
Oh, God.
We have Adam DiMarco, who plays Randall. Thomas Elms, who plays Hamish.
Hello.
Devery Jacobs, who plays Lilith. Katharine Isabelle, who plays Vera. Louriza Tronco, who plays Gabrielle. Yay. And of course, we have show creator Dennis Heaton.
Woo!
In the room. He's with executive producer and writer Shelley Eriksen. Sharing a camera. And then, of course, executive producers Chad Oakes and Michael Frislev. Thanks for joining us, everybody. Thanks for joining us. Now, to get started, for all the fans, we want to take another look at our season 2 trailer so that everyone's on the same page with what this conversation is going to be about. So we'll just give Rachel a moment to get that playing.
We live in two different worlds.
Babe? What's wrong?
I just had the worst nightmare. The missing billionaire was there, and there was this blonde.
Not again. Your name is Jack Morton. You go to Belgrave University. You have never heard of the Hermetic Order of the Blue Rose or the Knights of St. Christopher. And you think all blonde girls are stuck-up skinks. The powder isn't working anymore.
They could be powerful allies.
You want me to induct them? They're our enemies.
But they don't know that.
Tonight, we welcome 4 new members to the Hermetic Order of the Blue Rose.
These things inside of us want us to remember.
The Order took our memories.
But when the time is right, we're gonna make them pay. All of them.
I need a favor. Vera wants me to find the rogue practitioner who's been murdering students.
We're the Knights of St. Christopher. We fight bad magic.
Praxis is giving magic to hundreds of tourists, and they're trying to start the apocalypse.
Our priority has to be to protect ourselves.
Let me dispel the rumors. We are all going to die.
Oh, sounds like we're screwed.
You have no idea.
Where's Lilith?
Ooh, I'd watch that.
I'm gonna watch it again right now.
Dang.
All right, so let's give that a moment. All right, so obviously we have a lot of fun on this show. So I'm gonna start with Dennis and Shelley. You've created a really rich world of magic and given us even more crazy secret magic societies and whatnot this season. Can you talk to the fans a little bit about the process in your writing room? How do you come up with all this stuff? Praxis, Sons of Prometheus? What's your process?
We're driving towards a socialist future.
Yeah, stuff like that. We get a call from Chad, and Chad goes, "The numbers are good. You're getting another season." And we go, "Oh crap! We better start thinking about what we're going to do, because we kind of wrote ourselves into a corner last year," which is kind of the fun of, you know, doing a show like this. You just sort of go, "Okay, where's you know the biggest emotional point we can end that will result in hate mail." And then don't think about it at all until we know we're going to actually have to work on it. And then we spend the first week of the room staring at a blank wall going, crud, what are we going to do? And then it all comes from the characters.
You just start lobbing in things that you'd like to see based on what we saw in the previous season. Like, a lot of what we came up with is because of things that were built in the first season and things that we loved seeing the actors do and bring to it. I mean, that's the gift of those first few weeks when we come back, is we've got stuff to build on that we didn't even know we had when we were writing this the series.
Yeah, And there's things that we look at, like even in the moment of writing it, you know, we're just like, okay, let's just do this and move on. And then when I go back and watch the season, you know, to get those sweet, sweet Netflix numbers up, I go, oh crap, we can totally do this in season 3.
Yeah.
If we get it. Yeah. So yes. Not well that I'm obsessing about anything right now.
Well said, well said. Okay. I'm going to jump to the Knights of St. Christopher, our trusty werewolves. For you guys, you started off the season without your memories. What was it like to approach your characters that way? Did you do things a little bit differently? Was it fun? Was it a challenge? Jake, Adam, Thomas, Devery?
You're the knight.
It was nice to pretend that I could actually forget about Adam and Thomas just for a split second, because those guys are harrowing to work with. So, no, it was great. It was nice to kind of almost take a step back with the character to his roots of where he started off before, and not really knowing anything about any of this. So it was kind of like a revisit to the start of season 1. But the fun part was like piecing it together, seeing what this character was kind of having flashes of, what was resonating with him, why he was drawn to these other the other knights, the other characters, what they had in common. So that part was like really fun, discovering what we needed to and uncovering everything and letting the truth of that like play, which is it's pretty immense. Like it's pretty huge undertaking for these characters to remember everything they've been through, especially Jack. Like it's just sometimes maybe he wouldn't want to remember everything that he does, but that's the fun in it.
Yeah, I had a lot of fun watching Jake's scenes with Lo, where he didn't have his memory, and then we started getting it back and had to pretend like he didn't have his memory back. I think those were the most fun scenes because it's that extra layer of like the character is acting, which is always a lot of fun to play around with. I don't know. I think Randall without his memories is pretty similar to Randall with his memories.
Yeah, just jumping off jumping off what Jake said there, it's really interesting to see them as, you know, like normal human beings going about their daily college lives, and you realize something actually quite interesting is they're all very different, you know, like had they not been tied together through this strange bond of knighthood, they probably would not be in each other's lives at all. And so it kind of introduces this interesting idea, I thought, for me, of like, what exactly is it that is keeping these friends together? Is it love? Is it responsibility? Is it duty, you know, honor? Or is it, you know, just these, you know, intrinsic ties that like bind us together? And it kind of brings it into question throughout the whole series, which I thought was really interesting.
Definitely. And it was nice to see also like the wolves' chemistry come through, even like when we didn't remember, and it's like, oh, like we are still all connected, but I don't know you and you don't know him. And like, that was cool. But I think a lot of audience members don't know that we don't shoot it in sequence. So we're like, we're constantly block shooting. We do like 2 episodes in 1 shot. And so it was a fun time to be like, wait, which point in the story are we? Like, what do we remember at this point? Who do we know? Are we pretending? So it was just like, it was some like fun mental gymnastics for the wolves.
Well said. You can thank Shelley and Dennis for that, of course. Keeping you sharp. Do any of you actually enjoy wearing those werewolf teeth?
No.
Oh, nobody?
I would question someone that enjoyed that. I mean, it's preferable over being put into a tree costume. But
teeth.
Yeah.
We'll get to the tree.
About the tree costume, Jake.
I'll get you back one day. It's fine.
I did that. I'm way too claustrophobic to do something like that. I don't know.
I thought I was too.
Yeah, well, now that you've mentioned that, tell us a little bit about that process with that tree makeup. That was intense. I remember those days were fairly warm, and you were in there for a long period of time. But what was that like for you as an actor?
I mean, yeah, it was arduous, but in the end, I'm glad they went with the practical option, because you can try and just CGI and do it through the computer, but I don't think it tricks the audience's eye quite like practical does. And the special effects team, they did, I mean, you saw it, such an amazing job. But and I'm just teasing. Yeah, like it was hard, but that's like the fun challenge, and I think it was so worth it, and just so bizarrely fun part of the story to play out. So a couple castings and fittings for that, and then on the day, I think it took like 4 hours to get into the tree thing and kind of seal it all up with all the makeup. But you guys did an amazing job at like being ready and ready for me to get me shot out of there as soon as possible. So I think it could have been much worse.
Were people just like lifting you up and like moving you around, and you're just like,
yeah, I had
nothing. Was practical for a reason, was so that we could just move him around.
Yeah, yeah, feeding him lunch.
Yeah, the easiest day of working with Jake probably was that day.
Yeah, yeah. Refreshing.
Now a bad time to tell you that Tree Jake is getting a spinoff.
Jack.
I officially retire from the
business. Solves mysteries.
Okay, Lo, I've got a question for you now. This season, Gabrielle has become super fan favorite. People love how conniving and manipulative and seductive you are. What are your thoughts on why people want more of Gabby?
Oh, well, that's good to hear, because I feel like last year all I got was hate mail, which like I remember going to Comic-Con last year and everyone would be like shaking hands with like, you know, Sarah and Adam, Thomas, Devery, Katie, and then they get to me and they're like, hi, and I'm like, hi, nice to meet you, and they're like, yeah, okay, you're all right, and they'll like keep moving on. But I think Gabby did redeem herself a little bit here in season two, but I think that's just like the fun of playing her. She's so multi-dimensional, and I think as humans we're super complex, and to be able to play a character that is also super complex is an absolute dream. So
Good. That shows. It's been an awesome season for you, for sure. Now, Katharine, you're in charge right now this season, and then everything kind of goes to, well, I don't want to say really. What's it like, you know, losing your magic and also, you know, having to hold all that as a character, but then also on set, it's well known that you're kind of like everybody's big sister. I mean, we've got all these young goofballs, including some of the crew, and you're sort of our guiding light. So a couple of things for you to play.
Yeah, like I mean, it's shocking to find myself in that position. this cast is so fun and so talented, and it doesn't ever feel like a day at work. It's the best, most fun, easiest job I've ever had. I just get to be dressed in business bondage and be a complete teenagers all day. It's my favorite job. I love Vera so much. I love my office. Like, I literally love everything about this show. I love my character. I love my clothes. I love the show. I love it.
And you're very well dressed. You get to keep some of your.
I just got to tell Katharine, we did a podcast last week, and the interviewer on the podcast copped to, much to her surprise, Vera had become her favorite character.
Ooh.
Sneaky like that, isn't she?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that's definitely something that I try. I play a lot of harsh, serious, heavy characters, and I always try to find, even if there's nothing redeeming about them on paper, I always try to find some kind of likability in there. And Vera has many on paper likable moments, but it's nice to know that people grew fonder of her and came around to see that there is a gentler, squishy jelly inside of this cold stone. So I'm glad.
I feel like that was kind of similar for all like the women within the season two. Like we saw even like Devery and like her playing Lilith, her softer side almost, especially when she like sacrificed herself for Jack, you know. I think that was sort of like almost a surprise to everybody,
and we love to see that, because there are so many, you know, there's these great strong female characters, but sometimes people stop there. They're like, we got a strong female character, and they don't flesh them out fully and make them human and make them multidimensional and make them intriguing in that way. So thanks, guys.
Anytime. I will say one side note is I got a bigger response from my family of the smile on Vera's face when she turns Ian into Jason Priestley. Then pretty much like, and like everything else, they're like, yeah, this is pretty typical you, werewolves and magic, but that moment when Vera did this, that was awesome.
That really threw them for a loop.
Okay, guys.
literally one of my favorite moments on the show. I laughed very hard that day. And that actually leads me to a question for Chad and Mike, our executive producers. Now, you guys are known for bringing the best talent around to your shows, probably because you've been producing, you know, hit television for so many years. Whose idea was it to bring on Jason Priestley and Ian Ziering for these cameos? Or was it Dennis?
Well, it started first off, we started earlier trying to figure out who we were going to bring on because we had mentioned Oprah, Clooney, there was a whole bunch of people, and I called all of them and none of them responded. So. So anyway, so we went through a little list of people that we knew that we love. That's a part of our Nomadic Pictures Clubhouse, and Dennis and I had talked about it, and Shelley had talked about Jason. And then when we were flying down to Comic-Con at the Vancouver International Airport, sitting there amongst all of the actors, when I got there is IZ, and he was doing something else in Vancouver, and he literally flew with us down. We invited him to dinner. And then, you know, we were all sitting there, and Regina was sitting next to me, and we were all looking, and we're like, okay, is it a given? Should we just put these two together? And so Dennis and Shelley put this lovely little twist together. So, and of course, it was two phone calls to two pals who I've known for many years, and they said yes. So it was great.
And David Von Anken did such a nice job on that episode with those two as well. So. These are relationships that we've had for years. I mean, we go way back with Jason, and certainly with IZ, Chad has known him for quite a while. And we were happy to run into them, into IZ at Comic-Con last year and everything. And, you know, that's spawned all the Mishigosk and the fun. So it was great to see, really great to see.
And it worked, thanks to Shelley and Dennis in the writing. And I know that for any reason, if we're fortunate and to get a season three, we must carry that on and bring in some more people, some more cameos.
Honestly, it's one of my favorite moments is when the doors open and Tom's character goes, Jason Priestley and Ion Ziering. Those guys were champs. I mean, they would let us do any insult to utter at the other. Yeah. They came up with some
of their own.
Yeah.
Yeah, it almost made filming on a Saturday worthwhile.
It was a Saturday. Right. It was a Saturday. That's right.
Yes,
and actually, now that you mention it, and we've got this big Comic-Con audience, is there any other people on your fantasy list that could be members of the Order in seasons to come?
Yeah.
Yeah? Do you want to share any of them? Any hopes? Any call-outs?
About Morris?
Yeah. At one point, Adam's character, Randall, ends up saying, like, Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez was, like, rumored to be in the Order, and I'm just like, AOC, I'm down for that. I'm ready to see it.
I want Cher to make an appearance as Vera's mother.
Yes! Yes!
Chad can erase that, for sure.
We're very fortunate to actually have an in with Cher. So hopefully, my dear Cher, if you're watching... Sorry, it didn't work out on Van Helsing, but how about the Order? It's your invite.
Awesome. Hey, so over and above all the crazy, fun, magical world that we create, a lot of the fans tune in and love all the wacky romance that goes on with you guys. So we're going to talk about that a little bit. One big story this year was Lilith and Nicole.
Yes.
So, Devery, talk to us a little bit about, you know, that development for your character.
First, I want to give a shout out to Anisha Bailey, who plays Nicole.
Anisha!
Who is, like, so lovely and so talented. It was like such a pleasure to work with. It was so funny because last season in season one, there wasn't any like love interest for Lilith at the beginning half, and you guys hadn't written the second half yet. And so I had made an executive decision where I was like, Lilith's totally queer. Right? Like, she's really bi. And so that's how I had played her. There's even a couple moments where it was like, oh, I loved Alyssa once, like a sister, you pervert. So it was like, was it really? And but then towards the end of the season, Adam, you and I had read it, because we're like, oh dang, like we have a romance in here, we're like, we better start playing it. And that was like so much fun, and I love the love triangle that ensues in season two between Nicole and between Randall, and the confusing feelings and things like that. But it was cool to see how audiences picked up on my character attribution to Lilith in season one, because even like queer social media came out of the woodworks and they were like, Lilith is bi, right? Lilith is bi, and that came everywhere. And then when season two came up, it was like, obviously, yes. And yeah, just like working with Anisha has just been so awesome and so much fun.
Yeah, it shows for sure. Awesome. Now, sadly, we can't have Sarah with us today, but I know that's her relationship, Alyssa, and...
ooh, that headshot!
It's intense!
Jamie!
What's that like, Jake, with all that constant tension of, like, back and forth to play with Sarah on set?
It's fun. I mean, these characters want so badly to kind of be on the same side and be on the same team, but they their morals just kind of like never let them get there, and so there's always this almost like tension or race to get there, and then it seems as soon as one of them gets somewhere, the other is in a different place. And they do have glimpses of it, which is I think is really like important for these characters, like especially Jack, because he doesn't have much of like a family or these kind of like love connections anymore. And I think just kind of the affinity he has for Alyssa is super important and a driving force. And even when she starts kind of turning throughout the season, he's always kind of defending her and looking out for her and having her back, which I think is super important, because I go, what does this Jack character have to live for? You know, he's lost a lot of people around him, and a big part of that is Alyssa. And so I think they get these really sweet moments together, which you know, fans love to see, but it's always kind of at an arm's length. And yeah, I just love how they both do like a 180 in the season. You know, like Jack wasn't into the order and he gets on board with it, and then Alyssa isn't. And I think, you know, going forward, you know, if there's a season three, I think a huge part of that is going to be him trying to get her back at any cost, which is going to be crazy. So
great moment to go to a clip.
Well, you know what, we do have a really great clip to watch, because as everyone knows, you guys write some of the most gut-wrenching endings, and we do have a clip from the end of season two, most of the scene, and not the full ending, but let's take a look at that, Rachel, so we can talk about that a little bit.
Salvador was a greater leader than you ever were.
Alyssa, don't. Revenge is never worth the cost. You're the one that taught me that.
This isn't revenge. This is justice.
No, it's revenge.
This is anger. Alyssa, I know, because I've been there. Don't make the mistake you stopped me from making.
After everything that she's done, she doesn't deserve to live.
Well, then neither do I. If all this is anyone's fault, it's mine.
Jack, no.
And if you have to kill someone to feel better, make it me. Because once you kill Vera, the Order targets you. And I can't live in a world without you in it.
It's always about you, isn't it?
I like being the center of attention. So you have to go now. Or right. Gabrielle is possessed by Midnight, and as far as he's concerned, you're both the enemy.
Return my magic?
Not gonna happen.
Go.
Bye, Jack.
Help her.
I can't. I don't.
Please! Alyssa, you have to return Vera's magic. Alyssa?
I could call 911.
Alyssa, you have to return her magic. No. Alyssa.
I know, it's intense. What's going on?
Why would you do that, Dennis and Shelley?
They told me to do it. Okay, they
so
told
what
me.
Happened was is Sarah and I were in lunch, and Sarah took the last cheesecake.
Rookie mistake.
I'm going to kill you.
That seems
like Sarah's lactose intolerant. She would never do that.
No cheesecake.
Well, then she took it for someone else. Whoa.
That scene was hard to watch because, like, growing up, my best friend was killed by a werewolf.
Oh, really triggering for you?
Triggering. But honestly, there, I mean, the fans, as you know, would respond the way it responded, and they're clamoring to know: is Alyssa really dead?
Of course she is. She was killed by a werewolf.
Yeah, you just saw her die.
Yeah.
Well, come on.
Her throat was ripped out.
You don't survive that.
People die when their throats get ripped out by werewolves. Ask Brandt, not ask Adam.
Yeah, ask Adam's friend.
Sorry, Adam.
All right. We'll give them that bad news. Yeah, but again, that was one of the big fan questions. Another big fan question, too, is Lilith a demon now?
Now or
she ever not?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a
question. I think it is a romance question too.
Was there
a what question?
There's one more romance that I hoped you were gonna
Oh there to. Yes. Well, of course it's another romance question, of course. Everyone wants to know a little bit more about Hamish and Vera.
Hamish.
Hamish.
Yeah, who knows? Yeah. Who knows where that'll go? I mean, I need him now that I'm powerless. So even if I wanted to get rid of him, I can't.
Finally.
Finally, you're indispensable.
Is it a relationship?
Yeah, I think this is the reason why I think everyone needs to put a hand up that we have to come back and do another season to answer these questions. Is everyone good with it here?
Yeah,
there are too many questions to be answered. Put your hand up, Dennis.
I did.
Your contract negotiations are done.
She's literally popping you from the bottom right now.
That's the magic of Zoom.
Well, yeah, you segued to that really well, because the number one question literally on Twitter and Instagram, probably 80% of the time, is, are we going to get a season 3 and when? So I know we can't really talk about that yet. We've just come out a few weeks ago. But is there any news we can share? Anything?
We hope to find out the next few weeks how we are doing. And I know that the fan and the audience response has been incredible. It's been amazing. So we're very thankful to everybody out there for watching and the love comes through in all the blogs and the reviews and everything else. So we're cautiously optimistic, and we hope that we can have some good news soon.
So all of them should keep watching it on repeat, full episodes, all seasons.
Season two, all
episodes. Tell your friends.
Put it on when you're going to bed. Just leave it on.
Make your mom watch it again.
That's right. This is a telethon for 3 million more viewers. Now, please, dial in right now.
Absolutely. Well, we can ask people to do that. One thing we wanted to do, which we're super excited about, just for the Comic-Con audience, is we've got an exclusive behind-the-scenes blooper reel. And believe me, there are a lot of bloopers to pull from.
What does that mean? Oh, wow.
What are you trying to say?
What does that mean?
You run a professional show, Morris.
I think you guys do it on purpose. But yeah, it's really fun, and we're excited that we could share that with all the Comic-Con folks. So let's watch that as sort of our send-off, if you're all game.
Grand Megas, I... Bad time? What's my line? I'm so sorry. That was right?
Yep.
Oh.
Oh my god.
Dormi. That was so bad. Let's do this again. It's all so bad. Okay, it's gonna be so good.
Oh no.
Oh? Oh?
Go ahead, man.
One more time.
Where is he?
The light.
The light. Did anyone see that?
Oh, I was waiting for the snack.
Move.
Oh.
Sorry.
Mummified on the concrete.
Elbows.
Jesus.
I swear.
Jeez.
Three, I mean one, two, don't just pull.
And just pull. We breathed it this
way. Hang now.
Oh, us.
Us.
Stupid.
12 Anisha, take three.
12 Adam, take three.
66 Prometheans, take what?
26 blood.
26 artery.
38 delighted, take one.
Wow, this guy's sick.
In accordance with the laws of Enoch, we greet you.
There was a wasp.
There's
like,
so many.
Oh my god, there was a wasp nest. Oh.
There
were
so many bees
that
did.
Oh no.
He's obviously dead, dude.
He doesn't have a face, bro.
Guys, we can still save him.
No.
Oh. I love this.
Come on.
We've got way less strength now.
Okay. What kind of a water bottle is this?
Never. Push, not pull. Oh, it's pull, not push.
Boink.
They open out.
They open out, yeah. It's a pull,
not push.
Pull, not push.
Yeah.
Oh. Sorry, everybody mostly. Jake, this is a tree. Did they do it?
No.
Just yell hot or cold.
They sound like angels. Hey, do you think there's an angel?
Oh god, I wasn't expecting that one.
They sound like angels. We got it. They sound like angels.
We got it.
I'm hanging on by the thread.
Enjoy your party.
Yes. Party.
We'll enjoy, yes.
I cried.
Oh my
Amazing
God.
We get any work that. Done.
Yeah.
No fun on set. How did we actually make a show out of that?
That's crazy. Yeah. I feel so bad. So great. Oh, it was so much fun to watch, and so lovely to have all of you guys back together again. I realized how much I miss everybody.
Oh yeah.
Mm. Oh. I think my cheeks are hurting from laughing.
They are.
Oh yeah.
Smiling is so unnatural for me.
Well, thanks everybody for your time today. And if you have any comments or questions, you can put them down below in the comment section under the video. And hopefully we'll see you all again next year here or in person.
Yay! Go season 3. Love you guys.
Season 3.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
See you.